Right, good evening everybody.
Good evening everybody.
And welcome to members and members of the public. First of all, we have apologies from
Tony from Terminology meetings and Mike Mellows is working.
Right, okay, here you go.
No, it should.
Well, we've got to be back to situation tonight. Yes. First of all, do any members of the public wish to speak?
We had a petition raised about the dire state of the road on our estate, and I'd like to know if that petition has been presented yet.
Thank you very much. Right, so do you have any declarations of interest for the meeting? In that case, I'll move straight to item 212, which is the minutes of the meeting held on the 14th of February. So I'll go through those as usual by page 112, 184, 185, 186, 187 over page, 200. That was taken out of order, so members of the public must like that wasn't in sequence. 188, 189, 190. Over page 191, 192, over page 193, 194, 195, 196, 197, 198, 199, 201, 202, 203, 204, over page 205, 206, 207, 208, over page and finish. Is everyone happy at this? I saw those minutes, isn't that the record of that meeting? Could I please have a proposal in a second then? Is everyone agreeing with it? So, as we have a co-option, which I was going to take at this point actually. I think I have an earlier version of these in this, if that's a change version. Right, oh yes, Susan, yes, yeah. Oh yeah, yes. I'll take that, I'll take 217 now, co-option now. So that, if the co-op is successful, she can join the meeting.
No, thank you.
Right, so first of all, would you like to introduce yourself and explain why you would like to be a member of the parish council? What do you think you'd offer us? Thank you.
My name is Jane Merrick. I've lived in Sawston 20 years. I was born in Cambridge, grew up in Cambridge. When my children were little, I wanted to be educated not in city schools, I wanted to be in village schools. So I originally moved to Milton and lasted there 4 years because I didn't find people there that special. So I moved to Sawston and I found everybody here is really nice. It is a lovely village to be part of. So I've been here 20 years. I got work when I had my third child, and at that point I then helped in various the schools, the elementary primary school and secondary school. I also did a couple of years volunteering at L with the adults there. During my time not working, I also did the Open University Maths degree for something to do. And 2 years ago, I decided children finishing secondary school, I go back to work. I actually ended up back up at the company that I originally trained with in Cambridge. They moved where they were though, so I left there. Unfortunately, my husband became ill, so I gave up work and only went back to work last year. My youngest is at Melbourne University, hopefully in September. I only work 2 days a week at Sandcroft in the village, except in January where I work full time because it's very busy. I have a lot of free time and I'd like to give back to the village a bit because I've used all the facilities. And I think too many people moan about it, because actually I'm doing anything about it.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone have any questions? Jane?
Okay. Yeah. There's a couple of silly questions really, but okay. We had members on here before who didn't have a place to go in the village.
I'm improving. I know, I live in Churchfield. I know that's...
I know where you live.
Yeah.
But do you know... do you know where the hardware shop is?
Of course I do. I know where Spice is.
Do you know where Spice's Field is?
I do.
Because there were people who was on this parish council who didn't even know where they were.
No, I say, I use the facilities. I do know for a lot of things. And I use
them. No, but I'm just saying, somebody comes on this parish council, they don't know where they are.
Is this one of
the national people's parish council?
Well, no, at least you know that.
Sorry, can we have one at a time, please?
The co-op wasn't asked these questions.
Well, members did ask for a questioning session previously.
Yeah.
I have no control over the
questioning.
I mean,
the
questioning
of this.
If something
decision.
Is entirely
out of order, people should know where the places are if they come on the parish council.
Okay. But there's no obligation.
Sorry. Join the parish council if you don't know where the places are.
Right. Okay. Are there any other questions?
Somebody that doesn't know where everywhere is in the village. Can I just ask why now?
I haven't become too involved with a lot of things because I always wanted to be around for my children if they need anything. I had a particularly traumatic 12 months losing my husband last year. So I've had to be around even more for my children. My oldest now is in Ireland. My middle one is a secondary school teacher at Coleridge. And my youngest goes to university this year. So I have more time. I'd like to use that time rather than just sit around and waste it. Because you don't get time back once it's gone.
Are there any other questions? Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm just explaining, sorry.
Yeah, I was just going to say people stop.
Yeah, so just explain the procedure. Now to ask to leave the room, I'll leave the ballot. There's no further debate. We just vote now.
Get to read out the right result.
Yes.
So I'm afraid Jane is not going to join us. Christmas, someone asked us to come in. I'm very sorry, but you're all co-opted. Just say one or two things. Normally, when people come onto this, it's usual to attend a number of meetings, and I think that might have helped if people have got more used to your face. So don't give up. Try again. Okay.
It's not to get used to your face. It's just that you know what happens
here,
so that we
know. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
Right, so we now move to the report from the Planning and Environment Committee on the 28th of February. Right, so again, I'll go through these by item. Page 1, paragraph 1, 2, 7, over page.
Yes, can I just have a point in the second paragraph, page 2?
Let me get to it. Can we change it?
Sorry.
Sorry.
I think it's worth, I don't think we specifically mentioned safeguarding, and so I'm going to suggest that the second sentence of that second paragraph says, traffic passes through the college like all day for access to sports centre, therefore parking on the side should not be a safeguarding issue. That was a particular point of discussion.
Right. Okay.
Because that was a point raised, that we were discussing.
Okay, so you've got that one,
Can I ask a question about that, which just crossed my mind after the meeting?
Yeah.
There is some parking, obviously, on Mill Lane during the daytime that is rarely used for sports events during the day. And it's physically quite significantly closer to than the Bridge Hill.
You can cut through Martindale,
one of the things I was just thinking, if there is an event of some sort we might say you haven't got priority on that day, give them some warning. But generally, Mill Lane isn't occupied at all, is it?
Do you mean the recreation ground?
Yes.
Because there's not a lot of
parking. There's two parking either side. There's probably about four or five on the left hand side.
But you have to keep that right hand gate.
Yes.
The right hand gate's all
blocked. Yeah, it's not a lot of space.
No. So I don't know if you'd get 10 feet, because they're all about 10 vehicles, but I don't think you'd get 10 on that. Because it's the entrance up to the ground store and stuff, so that's right.
I've parked there recently, and it's not, there's not a lot of space. And if people are parked there because they're using the park as well, then it doesn't leave a lot of space.
I'll wait till they come back seven.
What comes back?
I thought there was a clause that said the contractors couldn't park on the road, but that was that just new road that they were to park on?
Right, okay. So, paragraph three over the page.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. I couldn't quite make sense of the paragraphs 9 and 3, because it looked as though I couldn't work out why the proposal of an offer to accept 40k towards Mill Lane, how that had anything to do with the previous paragraph, or is it meant to be connected? Or?
Well, this is, yes.
Yes,
you recall we initially tried for $64,000. We're in $63,000.
It's just not mentioned. Nothing to do with the pavilion is mentioned in the previous paragraph. So
it does mention an increase in the S106 contribution. The increase was to justified by highway works.
So has there therefore been a formal offer of 40k?
There has. Yes. Yes. That was the original. It looks as if the developer may be dropping the table.
Right. I wasn't at the meeting, so I can't say for certain. But I would have thought that something.
If you feel that there's a word or two clarifications in there, I'm open to that.
Yes, that's what I was thinking.
If you just said in that first sentence, after S106 contribution of
68k
instead of 40k. Yeah, that's fine.
Yes.
The initials,
estimates
of
what we might spend.
If members feel that was clarified, if the chair of the committee is happy, it probably ought to be in brackets because I don't remember the figure actually being discussed, and I think if anyone else was looking at these minutes, or an alternative is to insert the word original,
so to accept the original offer of 40k.
That would be better, more appropriate to the discussion, I think.
There's a little time frame on the proposal as well. Okay, over the page, paragraph four, five.
Number five, left bottom application. It says the roof line will use the distinct character, and it's actually that the shape of the replacement roof lost the distinctive character of the original building. I don't know whether we actually lost some text there. That was what I did as well, David. Look over the page to see if there was a bit in the opposite. It's not the roof lining. It was the shape of the replacement roof. So it's got sort of mansard shape at the moment, and it was squared off.
So it's not lining, it's the shape of the roof. With that agreement, over the page, paragraph 6, 8, 9, and finish. With the proposed modifications.
Sorry, just one tiny change. I think that the footpath that Beck was talking about is footpath 9 rather than 8. It's the footpath to Whittle to, doesn't it?
I'm sorry, I'm
not
sure.
I think it's 9.
The one that goes
into
the one that comes out by the school, yes.
Is that 9?
Yeah.
I'll write it down in the
Item 215, minutes the cemetery committee held last week on 7th of March. So again, page 1, paragraph 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, over page 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
I'm not having time to read them, and they've been told this meeting, right. So we'll just have a bit of time to read through them.
We're up to 11, so...
Sorry, can I just retract? We wouldn't be taking decisions at an April 4 parish meeting. Is it? Are we talking about the annual meeting? Are you up to 11?
Yep.
Okay. Can I move on then? 12?
Yep.
Or 13, 14, and 15? Is everyone happy to accept those as a record of that meeting? So I want to propose them, please. First by Janet, seconded by Roger. All those in favour, please indicate. Thank you.
Is the request for the bench something that needs further discussion? It does seem a shame that if relatives of people buried in the cemetery wanted to donate something, that we
We just had quite a long discussion about it. It's always a very awkward and sensitive issue, and I think we're all sensitive to that. But if a large number of people chose to make benches, there would be quite a lot of benches up there, I think. That's all.
I visited both the cemeteries.
Yeah.
And I could see the benches were not in good
nick. Yes. Yeah.
I can understand that the people who have put the bench there, it is their responsibility to look after the benches. If they don't, what happens?
Well, we'll write to them, ask them, and then
if they don't do anything about it, Vera,
we'll write to them again. But yeah, we try and get in contact with someone from the family.
I feel personally, what is stopping Parish Council from keeping those benches in good order?
We don't own the benches, it's the families that own the bench.
It reflects on us, doesn't it?
I mean, it's... I suppose it would be open to the council to make it a condition that the benches were in effect donated to the council and we took on them. I mean, that would be a possibility. I mean, if members wish, we could refer that back to the next cemetery committee.
Yeah.
Yeah, then Anna's got fine time.
Well,
yeah.
And then people, a few years down the line, they just let someone wait there and then it's...
But the point I'm making is that it reflects on the councillors.
Oh, it does, yes.
I mentioned I'm not taking good. It does not help when there are a few nails sitting out. If somebody sits and tears their clothing, it's not going to help either.
Yeah, but I think Alan does check.
I was going to say, we do check them,
It's just a matter of cleaning them, just take time.
And we do go up, we do regular checks up there. I know Anne looks after the secretary and she'll go up.
The quality of bench provided, because obviously a bench which goes in a public place has to be rather more robust than one which, say, we have in a garden. So there is a sort of minimum specification.
Could it be referred back to the cemetery committee to discuss? Because presumably there's a principal policy.
Well, yes. You've got a valid
It should be present.
Our members happy for that to be referred back to cemetery then. So I think we're on to 216, which is actually accounts for the month, which have been circulated in your papers. Are there any questions or queries? Are there any queries or questions?
Is there anything significant that we should be aware of for
we've had a proposal in the second. All those in favour? Right, now move on to item 218, planning applications associated matters. First one is construction of attached two bedroom houses on 19 Sawston Avenue, which is considered a rather similar application quite recently.
Similarly done with you.
Yes, I did go and have a look at this, 19 Sunderland Avenue, and in fact, right next door, they've done actually the same thing. There's number 21 and a number 21A, although the design isn't quite the same. What they've done at 21A is join the two up the first story. There's like a walkthrough underneath. Right. To one side on 21A. So as far as I can see, this one will kind of be a build across the garage where there's also a side door on number 19, and then there's a gap left between the two buildings, although it looks as if it's not going to be quite as wide as the gap that's already there. In terms of how it sort of fits in, it didn't look to me as if there were going to be any issues with the development there. I don't know if there have been any comments from neighbours.
It might be worth noting that the agent is the same in both these cases, so there might well be somebody who's going around making offers to householders for projects like this. I noticed the same mistake occurred in both heritage statements as well. Both described the development as a modest three-bedroom house. In fact, both these houses are two bedrooms, aren't they?
Yes.
I think somebody's put together a boilerplate.
Well, Mr. Fry, he's quite well established Asian in the area, and he's been around quite some time, about many years ago, as an officer of South, etc. So it's, I don't think this is, I don't think this is a company writ going around
counting
In fact, if you walk around Sawston, you'll see lots and lots like this, you know, waiting to be developed in, on corners or in people's, you know, gardens.
Is that right? On the wrong way.
If you walk around, yes, you will see spotlights, Brian.
Which one is it?
It's number 19.
I think I particularly noticed the number of bedrooms, because it's always in the back of my mind that actually what we need is smaller houses, because everybody else is extending the houses all the time, so there's very little cheap housing.
That's 41.
No, that's 24 and 26.
Six is wrong size. Thank
you. Right, okay.
So keep going out.
So, oh, thank you.
Yeah. Janet, you were proposing to support.
This one's it.
Do I hope?
Rather seconded. Is there any further discussion on this item before I move to the vote?
Yes, I mean that's
not the whole story, because something would be unsatisfactory. I'm not saying that's so in this case, but I mean, you know, the fact that there's no major complaints doesn't necessarily mean it's in planning terms. Right, so so all those in favour. Right. And two no votes. Just explain to him as the public that there's a myself and vice chair who are not voting because we're chair and vice chair of planning committee at South Cams, and this is why I don't express an opinion on these. I just mention any issues. Right, so if we can now move on to S0705-17FL, which is a full application for construction of a two-bedroom house at 24 Springfield Road. And you'll recall that there was a three-bedroom proposal used on the site quite recently, since I'm here in the late autumn, which the parish council did not support at the time. I have here the delegation report, and I'll happy to read out the reasons for the refusal. I think it's up to the committee to decide whether those objections have been addressed. So the proposed dwelling, by virtue of its width, scale, massing, and its projection close to the side boundary of the site, would result in an unacceptable visual relationship with the attached dwelling, an unbalancing of the existing pair of semi-detached dwellings, the loss of openness on views and on the street, and low varying impact on the public domain adjacent to the side boundary of the site. This would cause significant harm to the visual amenity of the area and would be contrary to policies DP2 and DP3 of the adopted South Cambridge District Local Government. One of the issues which concerned the case officer was the fact that if you one of the sort of design points in South designs our points is that if you design an extension to a dwelling, it should be seen to be subordinate to the main dwelling, not equal. What we have here has been reduced to two, and it's been brought back from the boundary. So it's really up to the committee to decide whether you feel those reasons for refusal last time.
So it's been adapted also to the previous criticism. I mean, this seems to be very similar to the Sunburns Avenue one. Does anybody
think that
should have
different? Well, I did look at this one as well. It's an end plot, and the house at the moment has like a wraparound porch and sort of side conservatory. So this will replace the side conservatory.
So it's an additional house, isn't it?
It's an additional house. And it's interestingly enough, listening to those comments, the opposite side of the road, actually the houses are further down than the line of houses the other side. So on the opposite side, actually, this house would sort of balance up, the additional house would balance up the two. And then behind, there's a detached garage at the bottom of the plot as well. Yep. It's sort of round the corner there.
Yeah, we go around the corner.
So I couldn't see why not to support it this time. But I don't know what I can propose that if you like.
And there's a technical question, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
The extension to a house.
Yes.
Is surely a different thing to an additional house. So the requirement to have an extension.
Yes, I mean I think it's referring us on more general sense to a sort of to new development on the side of the house.
It's it seems rather odd to be honest, because to have an extension that looks different is, you know, a decision that's been made in those design guidelines.
Yes.
But actually the more sensible if it had been built that way, the new house would be the same as the others.
Yes, I mean, I'm only repeating the officer's comments.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It seems a little odd.
How exactly?
Joe, but
yes,
yeah.
Are you? Yeah. Excellent, thank you.
I mean, it's worth pointing out that the distance from the boundary of the common boundary of the house on these on the new plans is 4.5 metres plus 1.55, so that's about 6.5. Previously it was 6.9. So there is a reduction. There is a it is further away from the border by.
What were you voting for? Sorry.
Oh, four.
Oh, okay. Yes,
yeah,
so,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You're right.
Okay.
That is a substantial motion.
Yes, okay.
I've got one extension.
Two no votes.
No votes. That's gone through. Thank you.
Thank you. So, the third item is simply for information that the source and harvest of fine. Improved, and that was county application, so it was not.
Right.
Just
very
odd
to describe it as
a
retention of the Malvern Centre
rather
than.
Retention of the Malvern Centre, etc.
So I'll
just be
writing on that.
Okay, so that's 219, when we had our co-option originally last month, it was the first co-option we'd had for, according to my reckoning, 7 years. And we had to scrabble around a bit.
Oh, we had to
go to the there's absolutely nothing in our standing orders about procedures co-option. So in order to avoid ringing out the bell, if this doesn't happen again for a couple of years, I felt it'd be useful to have a paragraph in our standing orders simply describing the procedure. I mean, it'll be a lot of procedures from
the panel.
So it's simply served as a record of how it's done, basically.
And it would have been nice. Sometimes we get these agenda items and we're blind. Because although it describes the general context, it would have been nice to know beforehand what the proposal was.
Hmm. Well, yes, yeah, I mean, if you don't understand the orders,
but it will be, yeah.
Yeah,
so it just makes the agendas just going to be ridiculously long if we keep having all this.
I mean,
that's why we send out, I know I haven't on this particular item, but that's why we do generally send stuff out that we need to see.
It's not half the side of these papers, fair. I agree with Brian, I think sometimes it's a bit too cryptic.
Okay.
Taking a compromise between both positions, it would be possible for, if it were in the standing orders, for there simply to be a reference to standing orders in the agenda papers. So there would be a record of it. And my concern was it was a record of it somewhere within the standing orders of council.
I can send it all to you, what I put in.
It seems to me to be a fairly uncontroversial suggestion.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you.
Is it standard practice that there's no discussion of?
That was the guidance we had, yes.
Kieran.
I don't quite see why they'd have to leave the room then. If there's a secret ballot, I would assume that the person leaves the room still.
So with this amendment to the stand orders, just for this caution bit, I'll take it from the motorcycles, then I'll send it to you all before I
adopt them.
Right, so should we move on then to the remedial work required by the electrical survey? And I believe that to the cost.
This was, we had the electrical surveys done at the office Linton Way Mill Lane, and he's come back from remedial work that needs doing. In here, apparently, our fuse box should be a metal fuse box, not a plastic one, and they're not all. There's an isolation switch for the cooker that needs doing, and he's had to do some further testing at Mill Lane, which needs doing. And the cost for this would be £248.63 plus VAT. And no one, it would be sorry, plus labour, £574. But these are the remedial works for the electrical installation from the report that he's done, so you can't sign it off. And the trip switch, not everything is on the trip switch in there, which should be done. Really should have been spotted before. Yes. And
this is remarkable that a building that's less than 10 years old.
Yeah. You know, they keep all the change.
They keep
on
those to be in IC.
He has had to keep altering the IC electrical condition.
Yes, that's true.
I think they've altered it three times in the last 10 years where they've had faults.
And we've this done before, don't we? So if it's not really done, that wouldn't be.
Can I just clarify, is the person quoting for the work the same person who's done the testing?
The guy that came and done the testing, he's done a quote for. He came up with the work that needs doing, that he's recommended that needs doing. Obviously, he's not expecting to get the job, but he's given us. I've asked him to get a quote for it, which got last week. So now we can either get him to go and do it, do come back and do the work to sign the thing off, or I can get another, obviously, quote.
It does sound as though we'll...
No, the earlier test gets done every 5 years.
Yes. Yeah.
Could I finish my sentence?
Yeah.
It doesn't seem good practice not to get quotations from anybody else, because you wouldn't usually get your work done by the same person who said it all wrong.
It's fine.
Is it the wish of the council when we ask for
the only trouble with that, Mr. Chairman, is if you get somebody else to come, they might say that we want to do a SAT test as well. Although you've got the report from the first electrician, he might say, no, I'm going to do it myself to make sure.
Well, if he does, then he charges more, I guess, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And he
won't get the quote, will he?
Yeah.
It is a really good point, actually. Yes, So I've got a proposer and a seconder. So all those in favour of getting further quotes for this? That's his unanimous. Love Lights and Middle Lane and Linton Way. I think this is probably best referred to.
I still went for some more information. I was hoping to have it by today, so I'd like to defer that to recreation.
Okay, so Clinton's are happy to do that.
With regards to the electrical certificates, yeah.
Okay, from the first house. Do I have a second? Okay, all those in favour of referring this to recreation, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Request for a family fun day on Middle Lane on the 24th of June.
This is family fun day that's held every year in Middle Lane, 24th of June. They have it every year, they have football and that. It's on Saturday the 24th of June. Alan's quite happy for them to have it up there, so it's just an agreement.
I think if you propose we say yes,
Janet. All those in favour?
So,
resubmission of the section 137 application of Sawston Parish citizens. Do you remember we deferred this because we felt that there weren't sufficient details to enable us to make a decision. So you've now seen the revised form, and have you received comments or recommendations?
I'd
like to propose a smaller sum because I think it's a very small number of people who are benefiting, and I still think that it's very vague. I can understand that we could cover the shortfall, but there's no information about what other social functions during the year might be, and this is already covering a weekly meeting for them. So that still seems quite a lot.
Would you like to suggest
in terms of
feeling?
So I would suggest that
we're
giving
them
the £80 they've asked for to cover the shortfall for their
existing
meetings.
Do I have a seconder for that amendment? Yeah. Okay. Right, I'll now take a vote on that amendment, if there's no further discussion. So those in favour of Beck's amendment that we donate £80 to this organisation?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
And those against?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Right, so the amendment now becomes a substantive motion. And was effective. I won't take another vote.
So it's okay.
So we now have a joint application from the source and the Charities Trust, which is being attached to the papers. We've all had an opportunity to read them. They're asking £200,000 in order to organise a natural history education research family event. The application is for capital equipment which will remain available for future events at this time.
They do an awful lot from the village, they're brilliant open days, and it's good for the community.
Do I have a second then?
Yeah.
Is that's the 225?
225, yes. Is there any further discussion?
Yeah. Well, it's nice also that it's equipment
that
they'll be able to keep.
Yes. Sounds good. We'll put together an application, actually. So those are in favour. That should be unanimous. Speed monitoring and witness study. This arose from last neighbourhood panel meeting where the issue of. I'll turn it over to Colin because he's leading on this topic actually, so I won't speak your thumb this time. So,
since the last meeting, I've been in contact with Bayroom and Whittlesford and Chamberston. They all run their own sort of the scheme. They all run something similar where they have a sort of device that fits on a local somewhere and it records traffic, etc. They're all different. There's no sort of common, they're all done slightly different. My idea would be to have a device that records traffic as it goes past. Solar power, so you've got kind of that changing battery. Something that's portable, so you can move it around. And also, the idea is something you could just dial into, and which you can do, and get the information out. One of those, it depends where you go. I only got some more information yesterday, so I'm still looking into sort of the actual cost. But one of those will cost, it's around £2,700 to get one of these devices that could be strapped to any pole. As long as the bottom edge of it is more than 2.1 metres above the ground, which does mean in some places you are going to have an extension or you do whatever. But my idea is not, if you have it plugged into the mains, then all of a sudden you've got more costs. It becomes more expensive than it's all a fixed thing, you can't move it around. And my idea would be to move it around and supply information so that the police could then target. So that's what they want. They want information, and it has to be so basically in a 30 mile an hour limit. You've really got to be out doing 40 miles an hour before the police get interested. That's what they
think. Mm. So to clarify, you're proposing this really as an alternative to the to having a mobile speed watch unit.
It is what, looking around, and that's what others seem to have gone. They've gone down that road, and it's. As I say, really, if you have someone pointing cameras at you, all you do is slow down, doesn't it?
I think the other difficulty also that we picked up from the witness representative is that with speed watch groups, it's quite difficult to get an appropriate number of people. You need to get 3 people to do it, and the times at which you probably want to do it, which is sort of between about 7 and 9 on a sort of November morning, so it's quite difficult to get people out to do that.
So my idea is still
just on that basis. I was at Hazelfield yesterday, and I've got 16 volunteers ready to go, and they can't get the person to give them the appropriate training so that they can actually get out in action.
Anyway,
it's not good news, but I just throw that into the pot that they've got more volunteers than they actually need to do that.
I've just recounted the experience of Witness Group.
They've got a couple of the monitors in Great Shelf, haven't they?
Yeah, we'll see.
They're along here, but they've flashed 29s.
Yeah, but these ones, Collins, are going. Can't go 24 hours a day, can't they?
They
don't even disturb anybody. Yeah. All he's got to do is dial his number and get his information.
The only thing it doesn't do is to record numbers, of course.
If you made a line of roadworks application,
for example, traffic calming or.
So it's not giving you proof of the police at all, it's giving you evidence to present to the council for
you can also give the evidence to the police, and they will then do speed surveys there, speed traps.
Which ultimately is what we want.
Yes, yeah. Because as I said, basically, it gives you a database, how good the problem, where is it and how bad it is. So, it's probably, if that's what you're after, that's probably the best effective way of getting it.
Speed camera. Is there any way to, you can't do personalised fines just for Sawston Village, can you?
No.
Otherwise, I was thinking that would fund it quite nicely, probably.
No, I'm afraid, sorry.
Okay.
I think the police look rather poorly on the
internet. Presumably, the statistics that this thing collects is the total number of traffic movements,
yeah.
And then you get a proportion of those that are speeding.
Yeah.
Well, presumably, you just get a mass of data, do you? So times and speeds, basically, which is obviously the extreme process
to use for other things as well.
And what evidence that the police act on this?
Have you got information?
It has to be the thing. Speed, before they do anything useful, it has to be more than 15% above whatever limit.
Yeah.
Sure, but it will record all, presumably.
Yeah, record everybody. They need 15%, you need to be doing it in 30 miles, they need to be doing 40, and it can't be just be one car.
Yeah.
So you can set that information.
Yes, it's 15% of I think it's something like 15% of vehicles exceeding that high limit, which is the 10% plus class 2 or something, so I think.
No, not high speed.
Sorry?
Not high speed, not high speed.
And high speed, class 2. 2 years, okay.
High speed, it's within the, it's a different...
Still, the point is, I was still looking at the different options.
Yes.
That I thought about. See what we write out there, what the best way forward is.
Yes, you do, yes, I do, yes.
But still, I have produced a leaflet, which I was also doing at some point. I've got someone who can now deliver all the leaflets, I'll be sourcing.
Okay.
Which I've also been doing.
Yeah.
So, to make people aware of what we're doing.
Yes, so I think probably the way forward on this will be, when you're sort of under research on systems available, I think probably the planning committee will be the obvious one to bring this to. And then we look at detail and see whether we wish to proceed, make a recommendation to the council. Does that sound reasonable? And just to remind members, of course, we do need to pay for the installation of posts, which is mentioned in the email that was circulated.
Although we've got some spare posts. I walked past one tonight.
Yes.
Are we over the right height and sophistication?
It's not. Okay,
it's tall enough. Yeah, it's not just in your Colin will do a bit more research on that. When he feels ready, he'll ask for it. So go on the planning agenda.
The idea always was, this year, is to get a case together so that at the end of the year,
yes,
then we can go forward next year with a pot of money and we can do whatever we think is best.
I mean, it is a substantial piece of expenditure and there are, of course, grants available. I mean, I think, obviously, depending on members' decisions, the parish council will certainly look at funding it, but I think also if we can get external funding for it, then we ought to look at that. Okay. Thank you. Right, so staff first aid refresher course.
Self-conviction, you need to do the roof refresher first aid course, £70.
Right, so you'd like permission to go. Yes, I think it's important that you have this and have this refresh. So, something for you. So, so tree work recommended by. Mr. Norman.
Yes, so when the trees officer came out. There's three willow trees in Tannery Row by the car park which need pollarding. Another one down near Wakeland Avenue which needs pollarding because it's touching the roof of the house. And a lime tree in the cemetery which the deadwood needs removing. So these are all recommendations from him. I've asked for three quotes, managed to get two.
Right.
£845 plus VAT and £945 plus VAT.
That's for all those jobs.
They've got it running
the centuries in the tree. I think tree work is it's important not to delay because if there is an accident,
I think one thing to note is when Storm Doris is here, we didn't actually have trees falling down like other villages and that. I think it's because we keep on top of, because we have yearly checks and then we do the work, obviously, that is recommended, so I think that helps as well.
Yeah. Okay, so...
I'll get two quotes.
Would someone like to make a proposal?
For the 845?
Yeah,
845.
Okay, so I'll sit with them. Okay. Right. So all those in favour? We have a two pieces of correspondence. Thank you from the Sawston Fund and organisers, and also from the Summer Challenge. So, nice to get appreciated. Right, so. We don't have a representative from MPC.
Well, they're coming. The trouble is, they've gone to Waterford Parish Council first, and I hope to be here by 8.
Is that a motto?
I'll move to the end of the agenda, and if the meeting finishes, then I can't really ask people to sit here on your shots with them, so they're off, actually. But sorry. So we don't have any county councillors present, do we?
No, we don't. We've had the Tony's given this report to Dan. Dan's got a free start today, so.
Tony's report.
Yes.
Tony's report, there's the bit that I think we need to highlight is the local liaison for the 81307. David, myself and Brian attended.
And Roger.
Yes. Would you do
this is
a
from Pampisford.
I'm
coming today as well.
Oh, right, okay.
So the outcome of this was that there was a lot of concerns about it. One being that the rapid bus only went west, so it only went into Cambridge and not out. There was concerns about the perspective areas of the park and rides. There was issues around Linton regarding traffic lights and the roundabout, and there was safety issues regarding the way the bus lane works as you come down the bottom end of the course, the Cambridge side.
There was also an issue, Kevin, if I may, over the amount of time we were given.
The big concern about at the LLF, but members only got the report 3 hours before the actual meeting, and the LLM people only actually got it when they turned up.
Yes.
So the officers were berated about that.
It was emailed through a court.
And it was a bit of a shock for those in Mabraham who found that there were two additional proposed potential park and ride sites adjacent to their village.
This is something which is quite strange, because there is a discrepancy between what was presented at their meeting, which produced, I think it was about 7 sites.
Certainly 4 main
sites. Yes. And they were basically concept areas, weren't they? If you go on the City Deal website and you look under 1307 improvements to campuses, there are two very specific plans in Appendix B in that report, which show a fairly well worked up scheme to place a park and ride at Bayburn, south of the Bayburn High Street, and west of the 81307, roundabout onto the 1307, which I think no one disagreed with as being a vast improvement to that junction, but a widening of Bayburn and High Street, and two entrances, one for the cars and one for the bus, off Bayburn High Street with this park and ride. There is another one which shows presumably an alternative scheme south of Portland Ways, with an access again through a roundabout of the 1307 just south of the junction with the service area. And those look to me to be fairly well worked up schemes.
And there's also issues that at the time of the presentation that landowners hadn't been notified or asked or spoken to. So there's a huge amount of problems. Anyway, it came to the assembly at the City Deal, and the assembly members were quite perturbed, actually, I think we're quite well put it. And then they suggested that this item was actually deferred. That was taken to the board, and the bottom line of this is the chairman of the assembly took it to the board, and the board agreed that this would now be deferred until September. And they are going to do is have 3 workshops. The first one starting in May. The idea of the workshops is for the LLF members to attend the workshops. That will not be open to the general public. The LLF then takes that information to the public, and then they can feed back to the assembly. So that's where we are with that at the moment. But I just thought you needed to know.
It's fair to say that all of us from Sawston who were there, I think, all commented on the fact that this corridor of the Hay Hill Road is taken in isolation.
Yeah, yes. Yes.
And it's a particular problem for us because there's no consideration appears to be given to A505, for example. There's other issues further up to 1307 as it comes out of the Golden Acorns that seem to have an even outside the farm. The solutions that they've proffered seem to be rather full of holes as far as everybody was there that was concerned.
Yes.
Is that the fair
approach? It's a holistic approach that hasn't been taken. That's what they were looking at. And it was actually quite interesting. We had a member from the Burnjee Council, a councillor from there. And I think that she asked some rather pertinent questions that could not be answered at that time.
There was also one of the options was an off-road link, was an off-road link bus only and cycle link into the biomedical campus from Bayram Road Park and Ride Side. And there was a person there from the biomedical campus which claimed that had been rejected by the biomedical campus. There was no way in, basically.
Yeah.
Not a spectacular presentation. The other thing also is that this is that the Addenbrookes to Haverhill section, the Addenbrookes to Linton, the sort of light touch to this Haverhill section, seems to be being dealt with in isolation, and there was no mention of easing the delays which are now experienced on Hills Road. Where the buses don't stop at Addenbrookes, they go on into the central Cambridge. If there are delays on that section, all the people that was on 307 are still there, still having another service. And that has actually been made worse by the addition of those two enormous cycleways and the narrow green carriageway.
Yes.
I did make that point at the end, and there wasn't much of a response.
And there's another big cycle going along the A10, isn't there, up into
Trumpington? Yes, I know. That's a huge sort of earthwork there. I can't find anything on any website which describes that scheme at all, actually.
No, and it's, as well as causing delays at the moment, I'd be interested to know how it's going to impact on parking along there, because quite a few people park on the side of Temple Gardens are.
Yes, there's a bus lay-by down there, which is supposed to be a drop-off point for tour buses. And tour buses are a major problem.
Both those routes are issues for Sawston folk going to Cambridge.
Yeah.
Whatever route they choose to go, bus or...
Yes. I mean, as a registered tour guide, I counted 25 and 30 minutes coming down Cedar Street on a Saturday morning, actually. Are there any further comments on that?
Very disappointing, wasn't it?
It was very disappointing.
It was, and that was brought up at the assembly as well, when it was discussed as quite heatedly, shall we say.
Okay, so I'll now move on to councillors' issues, which I'd just like to start off by saying that for those of you who aren't on email and members of the public, we're very pleased to hear today that our application for a pedestrian crossing in the New Road has been accepted. And I'd like to thank members for bringing that forward. Kevin and I attended the presentation, and glad to hear that I'll now go around the table. So, Brian?
Just a couple of things. Probably at the next call, can we talk about the grants that are available from an organisation called Groundworks? I'll bring some information, and if you can send off forward to someone to you to...
What are all sorts of things.
Playgrounds, for example, but a whole variety of stuff, and there may be funds available to us too.
And the second, Storm Doris.
Would it be more appropriate for that to recreation?
I think because there are... There's more than just playscapes.
Okay.
So, I think it's all good.
Okay.
I mean, we might say we'll defer it back to recreation afterwards. Storm Doris has left a mess. And I've had a couple of comments, particularly about the Mill Lane wreck. And the path is very, very muddy. You could do with etching, so we're losing half of it, and people are struggling, particularly if it's wet.
Yes.
And I don't know whether the council can do anything or whether our...
Which
part? The one directly adjacent to the Mill Lane wreck.
Yeah, the county.
Yeah.
I'll report it.
Thank you.
Roger. Yeah.
When I complained about Hillside to Joe, they also sent me into highways. They sent me back that it didn't meet their criteria. In the meantime, Stuart Abercrombie, he's been in and he's written you a letter and he's been more articulate about it. But they say, the email that I got back within 24 hours, that they'd looked at it. I can't say they'd have looked at it within that time frame.
Mm-hmm. But it's going to meet the 50mm requirement.
Sorry?
The 50mm requirement.
Yeah. It's not only that, it's all
it's
those
lines as well.
The white lines that are missing, things like that. And it's where the white lines aren't showing where their driveways are, because people are, and lorries are parking there, and they're going out to the shops.
Yes, I'm not entirely sure why when the white lines are done, the sun in the village, and sort of carrying on the...
But only
the
ones that
are
faded badly.
Well, yeah, so... I've no idea what their criteria are, because I couldn't sort of... I think there are other ones that are just as bad as faded.
Just to send the white lines, which I highlighted.
Yeah.
They couldn't do it, because where the overlap of the road is, it's all disintegrated down there. Anyway, just watch this space and you forward it.
So I reported it and you reported it,
yeah.
And then Stuart came over the letter, I scanned the letter and that went back to him as well, so it's all been reported to highways. It's, yeah.
Right, Kieran.
Nothing from me, thank you.
Just to mention that I don't know if anybody else didn't have their blue bins collected on Monday.
Yes.
That's been major. Yeah. Well, of course, yeah. Some people were informed about why that was so. I found out on the Sawston Facebook group.
Yes.
I reported it. Apparently, they're having some teething difficulties, but that should be fine.
I have spoken to the portfolio about this actually. Kevin's in the plan, I should say.
They struggled the first week.
There were several down down the summer end of the village.
Next time round, I'm sure they'll be absolutely fine. Mm-hmm. And we'll give them a gold star. And another thing I wanted to mention was there is a mail listings on the 1st of April, Alex, and people there if they would like to turn up.
A mail? Mayoral?
Yeah.
I'm afraid I should be in Poland.
Oh, and we will be at the Free Church at
Free Church, it's on 1st of May.
1st of April.
Okay, that's so.
Yes.
Sorry, 7:30.
Yeah.
Free Church. County Council.
There will be county council hostings, but I'll mention those at the next council because they'll be.
Thank you. Okay.
Bill mentioned that white lines. It was white lines were being redone, weren't they?
They've replaced some, but they're only.
Not all.
They
won't
do the ones that are faded
badly. It was really under the road, about as far as Orchard House. I only got further.
They came out and looked, and then
did
the ones that
they've redone.
Yeah,
they've redone the levels, actually. They've made a good job on that section. So it's just a pity that the British could do similarly.
Can I ask also that perhaps there's speed watching on the agenda for next month, and so that if anything comes up, then I can have a decision made rather than just postpone for the next month.
Of course, yeah.
That stays on the agenda for now.
Okay.
No.
Couple of things. I was going to raise the rubbish collection as well, because quite a few people in St Mary's Road ran out, apparently.
Yes,
and so the call centre must have been quite busy. Mm-hmm. So that's that one. I was also going to raise the issue of the curbs and pavements, because it's awful everywhere. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is so bad along London Road that you've actually got sycamores starting to shoot up in curbs, and it looks awful. We've got quite a few events coming up early summer, open gardens, you know, family events, which are going to bring people into the village. I really hope it's going to look neater by then, and it's not just the curb size, it's the pavements as well in Church Lane. It's quite dangerous for elderly people, people's children, etc. When it rains, it becomes very slippery. So I have reported it myself, and Joe says that they have 13 weeks to do all this.
Well, I don't know if that's some things when you ask them, they say they're 13 weeks to do it.
Yeah.
I've reported it as well,
yeah,
several times.
Yeah,
and
is there anything else we can do?
Oh, actually, can I put you back on the thing about road cleaning?
Yes.
Just so everybody else knows, the mess from the quarry lorries continues. I've seen again that they've deployed a brushing, sweeping private vehicle along there. But the detritus that's dropping from the lorries is going along the lake by one of them parked in there. I'll show photo of a great lump of mud that clearly just dropped off there, as well as a rather bizarre lamppost.
Dropped off the back of the truck.
But I've been hit on the windscreen by it, and so we really need to get them to
Get on the place. Church Lane this week, because of the sugar beet lorries going up and down a lot of mud on the road there.
I mean, the route from Durnford should be along the bypass.
It's
going back over the bridge, isn't it?
There is quite a lot going on, actually. It's good to have it on the agenda, but I think, you know, we need to know, you know, what other organisations are doing, you know, so that we...
This was the event
social isolation working group, which I'm a member, so, you know, if we can...
And I'm not going to do that again.
No. From the comments made on Facebook, I wouldn't.
So it's just a waste of our time, really, wasn't it?
We knew it'd be a waste of time, but you've got to try and do something.
Yeah.
You've got to see what I'm doing something, haven't you?
A few things. One is that the Nova Forum police panel meeting that we had, the usual things were brought up, speeding and parking. There was another additional thing about the, I don't know if you were aware, there was this huge item on taxi licensing and fraud licenses, sort of making people more aware of when you get into a taxi. When you get into a taxi, to make sure that though they have got a license, you check all the documents, especially for the unfortunately for the female members of our society as well, and children. Big thing on online fraud was mentioned. Unfortunately, I think the police are trying to catch up with that, so they're still ongoing. Domestic violence, there's been a huge increase in domestic violence because people are now coming forward with it. And also cyclists was mentioned, because I brought up cyclists. The fact that you know, we've had the winter, we're coming to the spring now, that they still don't have lights and reflective gear, and yet the driver, if he hits the cyclist, he will be in the wrong. Which I think is a bit unjust.
Cyclists
in general.
Yeah, really? I see it's a problem in Cambridge City. I didn't have seen any cyclists in Sawston without lights.
I do. I see cyclists, no lights, no reflection on. Generally speaking, coming out of the pub. I go to see them quite often.
I think it happens everywhere, actually.
Yeah.
And it's not helped by the fact that street lighting isn't that good, unfortunately. If you take an example of going down Hills Road, where you're perhaps turning left to go into somewhere like the Perth School, when I go to the Rich Monks for a meeting, and you've got to cut across the cycleway there, and it actually is quite dangerous. You actually have to stop and look, because it's so dark, and as you say, cyclists quite often aren't as well lit as they should be.
Top of Link Road.
As we know, we have a fog problem on the high street, on the bypass, and that can be very unbreathable.
We have a meeting to encourage cyclists to light up.
Also, safety at the bottom line. We did have a small meeting down at Princess Drive regarding the state of the road. David and I went along, and there was a couple of residents who are here tonight that were there. They have got a petition up to for me to take to county. And it is, I have to say, it is pretty dire down there, and I do feel for the residents. So I will be taking that forward for them as well. The other thing as well, Park Road, up that end, I've had two complaints of people that are on motorability scooters, that the barges now are scratching their faces.
Yes, that's...
It's getting a bit of a joke up there. Somebody's got to take responsibility for that corner. It's either got to be us, the district, or the county. Because, you know, it's now been decided that they can take someone's eyes out.
They are rambles.
And I'll get a bit, I'm not being funny. Joe's been running around ragged here. if I have to take it on, I'll take it on. Poor Joe's been passed from pillar to post. But if the members of the public can actually write in and complain about this, it is dangerous when we've got barges that are overgrowing it on county areas. Please do. Let them know. Many voices carries much weight. So let's not just leave it to poor Joe to sort out. Let's all take a bit of responsibility ourselves and get out there.
More people that complain the better, because it's always...
And what about score? You sent round the website for the
for
the whole community to report as often as they see it, so that we can get some enforcement about that.
Absolutely.
I was just going to,
because
I've just been reminded about the same thing. So Joe sent round the email about that, and I shared it on the Sawston group. As well, so we just encourage people. So there's a new website that lets you report violations of parking restrictions, so you can report straight to the county council.
Danny and Mina have got a hotline. Mr. Chairman, just about the police panel, we also mentioned drug taking in the village, which has been reported back to us. Ollie Leonard is now Ollie McMeekin.
Yes.
And I've mentioned it to him as well.
He's aware of it. I've regularly given him a place, and it's 6 weeks, so it's all there.
I mean, there's been examples of quite aggressive behaviour in that, which is upsetting for the residents, obviously. Yeah.
Okay, right.
Can I just say thank you to Beck for doing the helping the chairman's report. So if you'd like to introduce yourselves.
My name's Tony Collins, I'm the planning consultant for Moto.
Can members of the public
ask questions?
Tony Collins, I'm planning consultant to Moto Hospitality, who are the motorway service area operator and provider.
I'm Mark Frentz, I work for Moto, I'm the property director from Moto Hospitality.
I'm Serena Daly from Meeting Place Communications. I think that's why MPC was on the agenda, but it's Moto is the developer.
Right, okay. What we'd like to do tonight is simply just introduce the concept. We haven't got any plans at this stage to explain why, but we'll talk about the project, the content, and then obviously throw it to you for questions, any issues you've got. Tonight is the first in a series of consultations that we've gone for a long time. There'll be further details available, plans, studies for you to look at, and obviously your questions can get much more detailed about those in due course. But I suppose best start with Moto, who Moto are and what we're about.
Yeah, just to put where we are in perspective, normally when we engage in communities, we normally come along with very pretty slides showing layouts and what we're thinking of and what all motorway service areas are different, and some are huge and some are much smaller. And the reason why we haven't done that, it's not because we want to sort of shroud it in local darkness, is that this is actually really early engagement for us. What we normally do is get all the plans, come to you and say, well, this is what we're thinking. What do you think about some of these plans, the elevations and some of the building treatments? Because of where the site is, as you will all know, it's opposite the Imperial Hall Museum. And one of the most important things that we've got to engage with, first of all, before we start putting layouts out that we think work, is to make sure that the layouts work with their operation. So we went to see them back in December. One of the first things they said was you should really get an aviation consultant on board, someone who can talk to us and to the CAA and all the rest of it. So that the next thing we did, we trawled around, got an aviation consultant on board who saw some layouts that we provided, then suggested some changes to that, talked about things like hedging, trees, the types of things that, you know, me as a lay person who's not an aviation expert wouldn't have thought about, but it's all about a nest of birds and bird strike and that kind of thing. So we produced a report, which we've now shared with IWM. We're trying to set up a meeting with them. We hoped by now we would have had it, but we haven't. but that's the next stage, to go back to them, they've seen the report, and then to start talking to them about, well, now we've got all this information back, this is what we were thinking of, how does this now work with you? So that's the next stage. So we'll eventually come up with some plans that have some more weight, that we'll be able to go back to the communities and say, well, we've talked to FWA now, and the reason why we put the buildings here is because there's the bike park here. We haven't got to that stage yet. However, we're also aware that because it was obviously out there in the community that, that Motor were proposing this, that it's important that we come engage early on. So we're here tonight just to talk about the concept. Moto, for those of you who don't know, you'll probably have known this as Granada up until 1999. Granada, there were TV people and also the TV rental people and hotels and bowling alleys and cinemas and motorway service areas were part of their business. Granada then sort of sold every bit off, and Moto with a bit, they sold off as a separate entity, and that's why we came up with the name Moto. We are the largest in terms of numbers operation in the country of motorway service areas, and we have sites that were built in 1961 to our newest site at Cherwell Valley, which was built in 2011. The reason why we're now looking at this area, as well as others, and we haven't just fixated on Duxford, the Department of Transport came out with a circular in 2013. And they come out with them every now and then, and what they do is they try and work out the strategic road network and the requirement for motorway service areas. In 2013, they made a radical change to the thinking behind where motorway service areas should be. Tony, who is the planning guru and who's been heavily involved since 2013 with this new circular, can explain what the changes were and why we're now looking at different areas of the country.
Yeah, before I go into the circular and the background to that, I should just add, our aviation report has taken into account the results of the Shoreland disaster. The investigation branch obviously produced a detailed report. Our aviation consultant has looked at that and said, no difficulty in relation to our proposal. But of course, you know, we've got to go through a number of stages. It's almost like a due diligence in any acquisition. We have to make sure the aviation's right. The aviation's right, we can then go to the next stages. So that's why it's critical we reach agreement with, or, you know, discuss it in more detail with IWM as soon as possible. And that request is still out there and we're waiting for their feedback. Coming back to motorway service areas, I mean, they originated originally from the first one on the M1, when the M1 was built. It was recognised at that stage that it was important for people to be able to take a rest in their journeys. Circular 2 of 2013, and I urge you to have a look at this in due course, sets out all the constraints and parameters and opportunities for the delivery of new motorway service areas. The government is reliant on the public sector to deliver this. And there's two principal objectives they want to achieve: safety and welfare. And what you are experiencing, and everyone experiencing across the country, is an increasing congestion. It's busier everywhere, slower on the motorway networks. The average speed on the motorway network is 59 miles an hour. That's the average speed across the whole of the country. So we've done a lot of work ourselves to do surveys of drivers, and we found, interestingly, that people are stopping more frequently over less distance. On average, people take 75 miles between MSA stops and 75 minutes, an hour and a quarter. That's significantly less than the government's own advice about taking a 15-minute rest every 2 hours. That mantra comes from back in the 1990s. And what the government realised, if we're going to actually improve highway safety, particularly in motorways, we need more opportunities for people to stop. You can go anywhere and you'll find that you'll be in big queues on the motorway, there'll be accidents. The average cost of an accident, if it's stopped on the motorway, is £500,000. So you can understand why the government wants to improve safety all the time. Anyway, Circular 2 of 2013 gives us some broad parameters in which we work. It says the maximum distance between motorway service areas should not exceed 28 miles or 30 miles an hour drive time, because a lot of
boats are congested, so it actually could be less. But there's no minimum distance any longer. The old advice used to be 30 miles, and at one point they went down to 15 miles, and then they thought, no, we'll change it again, back up to 30. Now there's no minimum distance. So what we've tried to identify with a lot of our competitors across the country are strategic gaps in the motorway network where highway safety and welfare could be improved through the provision of motorway services. We're pursuing about 10 opportunities. We've got two applications in at the moment, one at Rugby and one at Doncaster. This is one of the sites we've identified where there is a strategic gap. So between Birchhanger, for instance, and Cambridge Services, and I'll explain about Cambridge Services in a minute, it's about 37 miles. But actually, the motorway stops at Cambridge. So there's only one in the site on the M11 at Birchhanger. So this, the site we've chosen here, is important for lots of reasons. One is it's the actual midpoint between Cambridge Services and Birchhanger. So strategically, in optimising where you should place it, you should always try and place it economically and for all sorts of reasons as close to the midpoint as possible. And as part of the transport encourages that itself. But also, the problem we've got with Cambridge Services, a problem in the sense that it's not a motorway service area, because there's a little trunk road which is going to be improved, it doesn't count. But in the real world, you would say, it's a fully signed service facility. It's got for cars, HGVs and so forth. So we have to recognise it because we would put an MSA next door to it commercially. It doesn't make sense. So what we said is Cambridge is there, Cambridge Service is there, Birchhanger's there. This is the optimum location in distance term. But interestingly, everything north of this point is green belt. Now green belt is a much, much more stronger policy in terms of controlling development than the countryside. So actually, we're on the cusp of where the greenbelt starts. So in a way, we have to try and choose a site which is the most acceptable in planning terms, and we have to demonstrate that to the planning authority in due course. So we also say a bit about what motorway services are. In this service area, we would have the standard range of facilities, which would be an amenity building, which is the building that houses things like the restaurants, the shops. We had Marks and Spencers, we had Cross, we had Burger King, we had fresh food offers.
Toilets.
Absolutely numbers. And that actually is the number one reason people suffer about those services. Yes. And that's with lots of seating, cost of coffee, and if anyone's been to them, you'll find that they're evolving now much more to a kind of airport type environment. Lots of natural lighting, lots of natural air controls. Plenty of places to see, plenty of loos. So that's that part of the facility. We also have a lodge. We haven't determined the number of bedrooms yet, but it's could be 60 or 100. And that's really for overnight accommodation for people travelling on the motorway. Very, very popular and essential part of it. We have a petrol filling station with all sorts of fuel on there. The latest facility, which most MSAs are now going forward with, is a drive-through coffee shop, as would be a Costa opportunity. And I often describe this as, because we're trying to create a safe environment for people and where they can take a rest, even if you get them on an MSA, sometimes you can't get them out of the car. So drive-throughs have become very popular because what happens is they drive in, get their coffee, and then either go back on the motorway or sit in the car park. They actually just do not want to get out of their cars. And there's always a certain element of that. We provide parking for all classes of vehicles. That's HGVs, caravans, coaches, motorbikes, cars. Cars in particular now are moving more to electric. So we have electric charging points, and we future-proof the developments now so that there is the opportunity to increase the number of charging points as the number of electric cars begins to grow in terms of the economy. So a set number, but because we've got all the cabling in and ready, we can actually just increase those as demand increases. And we will move towards an electric car environment, you know, over the next 20 years, so we'll probably find that most of the spaces will be charging spaces at some point.
Last September cop.
Oh, sorry. I've got this degree of cynicism around.
No, there's no questions at the end.
Yeah, of course. Of course, each of these areas is also landscaped in itself, and that's set in a landscaped environment. And what we've tried to do is to screen these developments, and this is one where screening is important, but in a way which naturally integrates with the landscape setting itself. We also try to achieve right planting, the right approach to the landscape that suits this particular environment. You'll all be aware there was an appeal back in 2000, which was dismissed by the Secretary of State. That's why I say things have moved on politically now, but also there is no need case any longer. We don't need to prove need. So that was the main reason the original one was refused, because the inspector felt there was not a safety case that was proven to establish a need for a new MSF at that location. Now, that's completely removed. Planning authorities are advised that distances between MSAs are not matters for their consideration. They need to look at the planning merits of the case. And the other factor which was important in that appeal was the landscape impact. And that's something we absolutely fundamentally need to address. And when we come forward with our plans, you'll see those in details and you'll be able to make comments on those in due course. So the point is, there is a gap. There's no minimum distance now, but interestingly, commercially, you wouldn't normally be closer than 10 miles to a joining MSA, simply because you're stealing the traffic there and you're serving the same sets of people. Whereas if you go to a location like we're suggesting here at Duxford, equidistant between Birch Hanger and Cambridge services, you're at the optimum economic distance, as well as all sorts of other reasons. We will be doing detailed application in due course. So you have all details. It's bound to be an environmental impact assessment. So lots of technical reports on ecology, air quality, lighting, landscape, archaeology, heritage, all those sorts of things are part of the study we need to produce in due course. And you'll all be consulted in all that detail. Aviation is a fundamental one for us at the moment. Once we get the aviation sorted, we begin then to formalise our plans and then come back to you with that in due course. But this is really just the start of the process. I think that kind of technical bit.
Thank you. Can I just very quickly explain the engagement process? So, as Mark and Tony said, this is very, very early stages. We had hoped to have some sort of kind of drawings and things to share with you, but because of the delay of the IWM confirming that meeting, it's meant we haven't, unfortunately. The estate's been dying for a while, so anyone slipped from it. This is just our initial conversations. In due course, we haven't even had our pre-application meeting with the South County Planning Officers. That's the first step of the process. When we do that, we will outline to them these are our proposed consultation activities, check that they're happy that we're covering everything they want us to do. I'll be in constant contact with the various parish clerks and just saying, is there anything else, any meetings you want to attend, or any newsletters you want us to advertise in, those kind of things. Because of the delay, it's likely that we probably won't do the sort of full event or events until the early autumn now, but prior to that we should be in a position to begin to share details with you as and when we finalise this aviation report. But when we do that, we'll do full community events, widely advertised in the media, any other outlets you want us to do so. We have a free phone, we have a free post address, email, there'll be a website with all the details on, so we'll be as open as possible about
completely transparent, because it's our
between now and then, obviously, any questions in addition tonight you want to feel free, Joe, please do so. So apologies if we haven't come with anything physical tonight.
But and you'll have lots of concerns, we know.
Just a clarification, this is completely separate from the planning application just currently, of course, South Cambridgeshire, and the upgrade of the Beacon Station opposite.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, yeah. Just that's just a
clear. We are aware of that in these local concern that's good, but it's completely separate.
My other point, sorry, I think you've been, my other point is the boundary of being built in that part is a 5-5. So if you're going on the other side of that junction, you need to be built.
No, we're completely away from the green belt. It's a very important planning policy.
Right, yes, right, and then in here.
Thank you. You didn't mention transport issues, road issues.
It's the number one issue, absolutely.
We can't do that and all the other ones.
No, I think from the public perception, it's the number one issue of concern to them because the firefighters are busy. And I come back to the point I was making earlier.
I think busy could be an understatement.
Yeah. Put it in short side, yeah.
Gridlocks, morning and night.
That's the experience, I have to say, everywhere in the country. We've had the similar things with... Let me put it this way.
I'll explain where we've done two applications recently and where we went to see parish councils and when we were in village halls at a much more advanced stage than we are now. And when we've had all our boards up and we've had our planning consultants, however, as our communications consultant, Mr. Moto here, and he had powers consultant. It's always... highways consultants.
Yes.
where it shows this is how we're going to get people off the motorway, this is how we're going to show how people get into the site and then back onto the motorway again. And the highways consultant is the one who explained, and to put it this way, is that both Rugby and Doncaster are both sites where local villages and arterial roads go past the junction. And every single person who comes to the meeting says, have you been in that roundabout? And have you been there at 5 o'clock at night because you can't move in the moment? And we go, yeah, we know about that. Because, and it's not trying to be smart aleck about this. We're trying to say, don't worry, we can magic wand make it all better. In both those cases, we had two different highway solutions that according to the highways consultants, Highways England, and County Highways, and they're the people that we have to satisfy,
yes,
as well as the planning authority. So that, okay, we've got a site that's on the motorway network, but to get to it, people have to come off it, up a slip road, on a roundabout that is already busy. So what we have to do, I can't show you a sketch now to show you how it's going to work. What we have to do is show how, by putting all those traffic movements onto that slip road, onto that roundabout, bearing in mind there'll be people coming northbound who will come around the roundabout, and southbound, who will come off it, down to the roundabout and into the site. We have to prove to the Highways Authority, not just Highways England, that we can find a solution. That solution often is by realigning, by upgrading the roads, by
upwinding, slips.
We did at Rugby, we put another leg to the roundabout. So we created an external roundabout which solved the issue of moving to the roundabout at Doncaster. And if you
can I just, as a Doncaster lad,
A1M.
Junction 37.
Thank you. The Barnsley Road?
Yeah, so that application is a light application.
Yeah. Now that one.
If you
check online with Doncaster, it was submitted about 4 weeks ago. But if you just put A1M, it will come up with the details. That one's got an additional slip road coming up the top with traffic coming south. So it's traffic coming south on the A1M have their own lane to get into that motorway service area. So that's what we have to do there. But there'll be different issues here. The other thing to bear in mind with motorway service areas is that peak times for people in this area are the same as peak times for people all around the country. Most people are hitting the motorway network at 7 in the morning. They're hitting, coming off it, from 5 in the evening to 7. Those tend to be our less busy times because those are the times that people are all setting off or coming home. They're not the times people will actually stop and take a break. So the phasing of our movements, and the good thing is, being one of the largest operators, or the largest operators, we have got all the traffic movements on all our sites and seeing where it comes in and out. So we tend to sort of integrate around the sort of less busy times, but we still have to bear in mind that we have to prove to all these highways people, here's all the feedback we've got from all our other sites. But the junction site, just like this over Tamworth, for instance, this is how we get it in. These are all the movements. Therefore, we need to put this much amount of carriageway on it. So, the three most important things. Let's forget aviation for a moment because this is exceptionally different.
It's a technical issue.
It's traffic. The next one that people talk about is noise, and then it's light pollution. So it's all about: can we see it? Can we hear it? And is it going to affect us getting home? And those are the three things that all communities come to us about and say this is our biggest concern. And almost invariably they say you really need to come down here at these times. We have done that already. We've done that already on these other two sites, and Duxford is one of two others that we're putting forward this year. But we're very aware that we've got to come up with these solutions.
Have you commissioned a new traffic survey?
We will do traffic surveys. I mean, our consultants will be able to do anything like that. The other thing is, just a small point.
So I mean, it's not a central question to be asked. I should have mentioned at the beginning that if members could confine themselves to questions of fact. I mean, you have done that, so yes. We're not criticising anybody, but because we will be asked to comment on this application later on, please don't just express opinions as to whether we approve.
No, we like to hear all the questions you've got. We don't generate traffic, is the other thing that's important to understand. We just take traffic off the motorway and put it back on, but we do increase the movement at the junction, and that's what we've got to deal with.
So this is going to be accessed via the Firebird Pass?
Yes.
Not from...
Not directly off the motorway. That's right. What we're not intending to do at the moment.
So that will increase traffic movement by five.
Yeah, it increases traffic movement at the junction, if I put it there, but we don't generate traffic ourselves.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, but that's important. Thank you, sir.
Sorry, I have a very quick question because I'm behind the curve. Can you describe exactly where the site is?
Okay, southeast quadrant.
If you've got junction 10 on one side of the motorway, so if you're looking at it as a north south motorway, so on the left hand side, going north, you've got IWM, and on the right hand side of the junction, you've got the warehouse and the, if it was a clock, it would be at sort of 2 o'clock. Yep. We're at 4 o'clock, so it's opposite the warehouse, but on the Cambridge side.
So it's the old officer's mess, is it?
No. It's on the Cambridge side of the M&M.
It's the only sector which is not in green belt and not in Imperial.
Yes, that's right.
The next person I have is Alison and Janet.
Yeah, very quick one. Have you ever got a survey when it's, I know you probably have, when it's a flying weekend?
We understand the difficulties, that's why we're in consultation with the IW.
I'm talking about traffic.
Yeah, there'll be records of that. We haven't done the survey ourselves because we haven't had an issue since involved. But we will pick up the relevant data for that. Right. We want to form a strong partnership with IWM about how we can manage visitors to the air show in a way that benefits them and benefits us. We don't want people sitting in their car park for hours on end. There's all sorts of things we need to explore with them to make sure it operates well. We have 24/7 operation and there's only 2 hours free parking. We could do all sorts of things in terms of the charges that might apply at a certain time on their show days. Mm. That's all detailed discussion, but we are aware of it.
Okay.
When you develop the developments for the roads, how is that funded? Does that come out of public finance?
Oh no, everything has to come out of our. Yeah. If we're putting something there, that means the roads need beefing up. We don't then go to the community. Can you pay for it, please? We have to pay for everything. Yeah. So there is one location which. There's no relationship to yours, where we're looking at something like £30 million of road infrastructure. And it's, bear in mind, it's a much busier road than the M11, but we have to do it. So
government requires the private sector to do all of the work, and we recover our investment through things like the shops, and the sandwiches, and coffees, and so forth. That's the way it works.
Can I just ask one other thing, which
was
about the staffing of the unit?
About 150 jobs we create here, and they are all Moto employees, although they're badged as M&S workers and Burger King workers, and there's a whole, I mean, you'll get all this information in due course, but Moto have a full training programme so people can start at the shop floor, literally, and go to the ball, and there are a few people who have done that. but they go through the whole training process, they become site managers, anything they want to, but it's motor employees, which is the important thing. So we have, you know, we can move people around at any time, remote them, whatever.
Yeah, if anyone's been to, just to put that in perspective, if anyone's been to Cambridge Services, you may see M&S in there, you might see Costa and that. Those motor people in the Cambridge Service, it's not our motorway service area, that's a company that builds a motorway service area and then lets out space to various people.
It's extra.
That's kind of like a land
different model.
We just sort of, we are every single person on that site is employed by motor. Yeah, that's the important thing, really. So we have control of it.
So Roger, then Oriel.
No, my question. Oh, sure. That's okay.
I use the A505 regular.
Yeah.
And on a flying day, I can go up at Royston just to get to Duxford, and you can be out. People are getting out of the cars and just getting chairs out.
We can't solve that.
No.
What we
no, that's to make another thing is at the moment they're cooling down the M11 to be on the A505 already. You know, so you've got to work that out.
Yeah, we hope in our relationship with the IWM to create a situation where we work in partnerships where additional capacity for them. I mean, for instance, the lodge would be clearly taken up by people overnight. We want to do that. If we can create some sort of shuttle bus between the sites that people can get across there without having to drive. There's all sorts of commercial opportunities as well as hopefully improvements we can do. We're never going to solve the full thing because it's a monster.
So just take back up. That's one. You're on about a drive-through coffee place.
Yes.
Now, the place you're on about, you're not allowed to drink. And these, why do you know them? So why put one of them in?
There is demand, but what we
encourage...
What would happen in the absence is people often come off the motorway, go to the nearest McDonald's, drive through the, you know, the local roads and villages, and then get back on the motorway.
The point is, if they could to what about the outstretching, that's the point.
We can't be prescriptive. What we can do is provide the opportunities for people to get out of the car.
Yeah, but, you know, if you put them out, people are going to use it, but if they're not there, they've got to get up.
Well, you find that people, and exactly the same with mobile phones. Mobile phone usage has gone up 400% in the last few years in terms of people driving with their phones. The government are trying to stop it. Actually, MSAs at more regular intervals will provide the opportunity for people to stop and actually make a call. Now, we can't force them to do that.
I know,
but providing we can only ever provide the opportunity.
Yeah.
So we are now safety and welfare. You're absolutely right. There will be people who will abuse the system, whatever. But we hope by getting them off the motorway, actually it's safer. And you do encourage them to go to the law, you do encourage them to get a cup of tea and all the rest of it. We can't force them.
Oh no, no.
Right, Ray.
Yeah, I've got one concern actually that if you're going to build a lodge there for quite recently, several years ago, there was a one built down in Duxford
by the station.
By Wittlesford, and that was to take people to the actual Duxford Air Show. That's a Holiday Inn. Mm-hmm. So, what my thing is you'll be taking money away from these buildings.
Well, commercial competition is not a planning matter. What we would hope to do is lodges are now an essential component of all MSAs because people drive, they suddenly get tired, they do get the opportunity to stay overnight if they haven't booked. People often pre-book. They're strategic locations where people do stay overnight and you'll find them on every motorway service area now.
And actually, if you look at the capacity of the Holiday Express and the Hunting Club next door, often they're
capacity. I mean, it's no doubt on air show days, ours would be absolutely full, booked in advance.
But it provides heart throws with more and more.
The amount of times I advertise for a travel lodge when I'm going to Cambridge Court Exchange, and I end up, is it Cherry Orchard, and then I can't get in that one. It is amazing how trying to get a hotel space around here, which sometimes can be difficult. Yeah. One thing I'll say about the hotel, we don't run hotels ourselves. We used to when we were Granada Travel Lodge. There may be no need for a lodge. What we do is we'll put an application for the lodge. If in due course it's a planning application, and if in due course no commercial operator wants to run one, we won't deal with it because they'll be developing it themselves. So we put them into the application. They are normally put on motorway service areas. There is probably two in the country that don't have them, but it may well be this is one of them. So.
Yeah. But I think when it shows and the market demand for it's highly likely it would occur. But it'd be something like Travel Lodge or Premier Inn or Daisy or any of those operators who are separate from motor.
I mean, despite developments on Orchard Park, there is a recognised shortage of accommodation to get in the market.
A few questions. One is how holistic are you looking at this? As regards, now you're talking about, we've already mentioned that this is, I have to say, I thought your reply was a little bit flippant in the way that, you know, we always meet these congestion problems and gridlocks. We are actually going for a massive growth. Huge growth. Yeah. There's Utterfield's growing, Haverhill's growing, Bury St Edmunds growing, Royston's growing. So, just how holistic are you looking at your traffic reviews, your traffic usage? The other thing as well is what's the actual, although you don't have to give it, what is the need? Where is the need? Whose need is it?
The government have identified the need.
No. I don't want to know about the government's name.
Because you asked two questions, and I apologise for sounding flippant. What I'm trying to say is that it is the most important thing to locals is traffic. And all I'm saying is the last thing we want to do is be a bad neighbour who all we ever get is problems. Because if this congestion, it doesn't work for us either. So if the site becomes, if the road network around our site becomes congested, people don't join in. People just go, I am not falling into that one because it takes 20 minutes to get into it and 20 minutes to get out, and actually I only want to stop for half an hour. So it wasn't meant to sound flippant, but it is something that is really important, not just to locals, it is important to us as a commercial organisation. We've got to solve it. I'm not saying we've got the solutions, but it is top of the draw for us to solve that. Holistically, we're aware, the rugby one is quite important in that rugby is in a triangle of major haulage routes. There is all sorts of things going around rugby where we're putting on a site where you've got A5, you've got the M1, and you've got the M6, and you've got the A14 coming in. And everyone's going, well, that's all they're good for this bit. Don't forget, people are coming across here, and they actually cut through on this road because they want to. And I know that there are all sorts of cut-throughs that people would use because they want to get onto the 11 or they've got this. So we've got to look at not just the motorway network, our highways engineers look at where the traffic flows are coming from. So they can get the data from county on the A roads. Clearly, highways even will have all the data on the M11, all the movements throughout the year, and even on Imperial War Museum Airshow as well. So it is holistic because we do realise that, you know, what we don't, it is surprising, what we don't tend to do is bring people in from outside areas. If people happen to be going past a motorway service area on a normal journey, they may call in. But we don't get people calling in as we're a motorway service area, why not, we'll pop in there. If we're going past, they'll pop in. People don't tend to do special journeys to us, so we've got to just think about, well, who are we going to service? We're going to service obviously M11 traffic. Clearly there's going to be traffic going east-west on 505 that's going past anyway. Are they going to be calling in? We've got to work out those turning ratios as well, because we're not going to stand here and say, oh, no one's going to call in from the A505.
Well, we've got evidence that people actually do that, because we've got the McDonald's up there, and they go up there just go to visit the McDonald's, so you're offering a Costa, you're offering all these services, so I think people will just go out and call in.
Actually
answer the question, how far out holistically are you looking? Like there's massive development coming into this area. And have you taken that, like the
development? Yeah, we have to take into account.
That which is bringing in industry and more growth.
Yeah, so you look at the local plan, you look at the programme of development coming forward, and that all has to be built into the traffic model. That's all examined right the way through, because we have to not only look at we have to look at the year of opening in terms of when the facility opens, what are the traffic impacts that are arising in the network around it that could influence our MSA. So we've done exactly the same thing in Cambridge and Doncaster. So we're in the Lutterworth Triangle in Rugby to the north of us. Lots of developments there which we've had to take into account in terms of the feeder roads that come onto the motorway. So we do a thorough TA transport assessment across the whole area. That will be agreed with Highways England and the Highway Authority as a scoping before we do any detailed work.
and that will be part of our full detailed submission in due course. So we have to look at everything. We're not here to make problems, but we try and help to solve some problems where we can. So all we can say at this stage is we do look at the detail, we do look at everything on that.
You mentioned need as well, and you made the point we don't have to prove need as part of our planning thing, but why would we need to be one there? Mm. But if you go up most motorway, I mean, despite the fact that there was all these regulations in the early days, if you go up the M1 and go up the M6, for instance, they're about every 12 miles. And if you were building it today, you say, why is there one every 12 miles? Surely people can hold on to their bladders for more than 12 miles. But it's that sort of thing. It's, you don't know where people are coming from and how long they've been in the car. So whilst you think, well, it's not that far from Duxford to get to Cambridge if people are going up the airport, why can't they just wait 15 more minutes or 20 minutes? They may have been in the car an hour and a half, or there may be an accident that they've been through, and it's actually taken them quite some time. So it's those kind of things, and it's the reason why when we go on our travels on holiday, you go down the M5, you go up the M6 or the M1, or any motorway, even the M61, which is only 11 miles long, has got a motorway service there. It's because some people have been travelling 2 hours before they got to that point in their journey, and then another 20 minutes, the kids have already started banging on the backs of the seats, sort of thing.
Yeah.
It's the need.
And you get the emergencies. It's an interesting anecdote on the rugby one where we were talking to the community there. But the lady said, oh, I'm objecting to this, you know, with her husband, she was there. And the interesting thing, she had a private worker with me afterwards say, it was fantastic because I had an emergency once with my granddaughter. I managed to limp to the MSA, which was a few miles away, and I got help. But she wouldn't say that publicly, but she confided in me afterwards, even though her and her husband were formally objecting. He said, that's exactly what this is about. It's about safety and welfare, first of all. You don't know where accidents are going to be. You don't know where the next congestion point is going to be. So if you get them spaced right, there's at least something close by.
Interesting. Ron?
Yep. Okay, so just in case I missed it, and this could be quite vague, what's the sort of time scale?
Time scale, we hope. This is also getting things agreed with IWA on so we can get the designs, but the plans would be that we would start working on our plans very soon, start engaging with South Cams in the next few weeks.
As a pre-application.
Start getting the detailed designs worked up so that we would come back out to the communities with public exhibitions around September onwards. So we'll avoid the whole summer holidays because
we always avoid
the summer holidays because then people try to slip under the radar. So it'll be sometime September, October, when we would have public consultations, displays, exhibitions in the city centre itself so that people can see it in the shopping centre and also in the parishes. And then the likelihood is that we would hope to be putting out occasionally by the year end. And that may slip a bit, but within a few weeks either side, I would say that's probably the target.
Yeah. But in terms of the actual details, I would just to clarify that we'll run through our suggested activities with staff, so they might not agree with
that. And also the water scheme, how long would something like this take on average?
This is because of the traffic flows, this is not a large motorway service area. So if you look on the plans for Rugby and Doncaster, just bear in mind that those are both probably nearly double the size that this one will be in terms of the building size. I say nearly double, and car parking spaces. It will probably be, if you were lucky enough to get planning permission, you then have to sort out 278 agreements, which are highways agreements, and then section 106s. Then you have to tender. So you've got about, from planning permission given to actually starting on site, can be between 6 and 9 months. Can be. Say 6 months, and then it's about a 12-month build period. So you're talking 18 months after planning permission is granted is typically when...
But it could drift a bit depending on the circumstances.
I mean, you might suddenly find that you go on site, and we've had in the past where you've got an architectural watch and brief, and you start getting on the site, and all of a sudden you find something, and then it slows everything down. So it's variable.
And I did want to ask one other thing, which is, have there been any studies done on any kind of economic benefit in the surrounding area with anything?
There is a socioeconomic report which will come with the environmental impact assessments that will look at things like money generated, but particularly jobs. So we create 150 local jobs. Now, for some areas with full employment, that may not seem important. but actually employment is a fundamentally important part to any community. So we look at, and those jobs are not just sort of shop floor, they go right the way through. So, but also there's the wider network, the supply chain. Local businesses benefit from the supply chain side. So there's a full socioeconomic assessment that goes with it.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex. I'm hoping to close this meeting at 9:30, but I'm opening it out to the public gallery, and I've watched it before.
Oh, thank you, Chairman. I just want to know how much public engagement you're actually going to do, because you said you're reliant on the local plan, which doesn't exist, and Highways England and Highways Authority, whose data is 4 years out of date. So when are you actually going to consult with the public on two things?
It's two separate things. Serena's talked about public engagement. We have a very comprehensive and detailed public engagement programme through all media. So we have exhibitions, we have job fairs, we have a website, we have tweets. There'll be presentations to you as the community. They'll have feedback opportunities. So there'll be full engagement. You will find it's unlikely anyone will do a better public engagement than us in terms of that. And you only need to look at the Doncaster and Rugby cases where we've done that in detail, and you'll see that. In terms of the information to inform things like the highways assessment, we look at any source of information we possibly can. But of course, the starting point always has to be the development plan. Some of it could be out of date. But we also look at commitments, planning permissions that have been granted, anything that could have an impact on the transport assessment. So we don't limit that. We look at everything that's relevant. And that's why we agree a scoping with the highway authorities and the Highways England at the outset. They will identify the things they want us to consider. And that will also be true of the planning authority, because they're the source of information in terms of latest planning permissions, or if a big project is going to get permission in due course, is coming forward at that time to make us aware of it. So we do a thorough examination of all of that.
Could I just ask, I'd like answering the questions, are you going to go the extra mile to actually have what the community would like, or are you just going to be pointed in the direction of highways and the local plan if we ever get one?
We engage in everything.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to say, that's later down the line. Yeah. So quite a lot of developers wouldn't even come and have this early dialogue. We just wanted to talk to you and say, can we just make you aware that you know, we're looking at proposals for a development on Junction 10 of the M11. Very, very early stages. That's why we haven't come with any bits of paper today. We haven't even had a pre-application meeting with South Cams yet. And normally that's the sort of kick-off part of the process. So this is very much the first point in the thing. And that's, as I was saying, so the full range of events and newsletters and all various different ways and opportunities that we can give you to say, these are the details, please provide us with your feedback. The majority of that activity will be the early autumn, but the process starts now. So by all means, please, if you don't mind, continue to feed questions in the interim. But you know, well, this is the, I don't want you to think this is it. This is very much not it. This is the start. So yeah.
We don't want you to think this is it.
I mean, there will be a lot of people who say we don't like the idea, and that will be the sum total of their the representations. Other people will come forward with suggestions. You know, might we do this there? Or, for instance, it might be tourist information facilities, which are very particular to the area you want to encourage. And there's a great relationship with IWM we want to explore. All those positive impacts can inform the scheme as well. Mm. As though people are just saying, no, we don't want it. You know, we would address every point if we possibly can.
Right, only other members here, members of the public, members of the council who wish to ask questions.
We've exhausted you,
I'd like to thank you very much.
We will see you again, absolutely.
Are you looking at a huge gap between Berkshire and Furrow?
It's a very, very tricky problem. The problem is, do you know what the problem with that is? Most of that land around that M25 is even one built housing. Housing land is about 2 million acres. Landlords don't want it away.
It's all green belt. Yeah. And there are very specific circumstances about the M25 and under there. So as you there's a lot. We have
them. Yeah. Thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you.